Ladies and gentlemen, we're practicing social distancing during this ceremony with a limited number of personnel present, consistent with current force health protection guidelines, including mask wear. Good morning, distinguished guests, soldiers, and Department of the Army civilians, family and friends. On behalf of Major General Dennis P. LeMaster, the Commanding General, U.S. Army Medical Center of Excellence, and Colonel Wesley J. L. Anderson, 32nd Medical Brigade Commander, welcome to the 2021 Hispanic Heritage Month Observance, presented by the 264th Medical Battalion. At this time, allow me to welcome the command leadership in attendance. Major General Dennis P. LeMaster, the Commanding General, U.S. Army Medical Center of Excellence. Command Sergeant Major Clark Charpentier, the Command Sergeant Major, U.S. Army Medical Center of Excellence. Mr. J.M. Harmon, the Deputy to the Commanding General, U.S. Army Medical Center of Excellence. Lieutenant Colonel Jacob Bustos, Acting Commander of 32nd Medical Brigade, and Command Sergeant Major Gilberto Colon, 32nd Medical Brigade Command Sergeant Major. We are honored by your presence. Today's observance features honors to the nation, an invocation, the reading of the 2021 Hispanic Heritage Month Presidential Proclamation, a video presentation, special performance, guest speaker remarks, a gift presentation, closing remarks, cake cutting, and concludes with a benediction and the singing of the Army song. Ladies and gentlemen, please stand for the national anthem sung by Colonel Princess Aturase, and remain standing for the invocation delivered by Chaplain Vendres.
Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that a flag was still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
If you wish, please pray with me. Our gracious God, we come to you on this beautiful Texas fall morning to ask your blessings on this event today as we honor and recognize our Hispanic brothers and sisters who have served and continue to serve this great nation. We are so grateful for the way that you weave diversity in the tapestry of America and especially in the United States Army. And as an Army, we rely on the intellect, the expertise, the ingenuity of our fellow servicemen and women from Spain, Mexico, the Caribbean, and Central and South America. And as our Creator, you have made us all different from one another, but as part of the human race, you have endowed us with a need for unity in our diversity so that we can explore other cultures and enjoy what makes us unique. Thank you for the many Hispanic lives who persevered in some of the most difficult times that remind us all that we too can have hope. I pray your blessings on Colonel Smyth as she shares her story, that it would inspire all who listen. Thank you, Lord, that we can pause on this Friday morning to share this special time together and learn something new about Hispanic heritage. Amen.
Every year, the Department of Defense joins the nation in celebrating and honoring the cultures and contributions of Hispanic and Latino Americans. This year's theme is Esperanza, a celebration of Hispanic heritage and hope. On September 17, 1968, Congress passed Public Law 90-48, officially authorizing and requesting the President to issue annual proclamations declaring September 15th and September 16th to mark the beginning of National Hispanic Heritage Week. President Lyndon B. Johnson issued the first Hispanic Heritage Week presidential proclamation on September 14, 1989. President George H.W. Bush became the first president to declare the 31-day period from September 15th to October 15th as National Hispanic Heritage Month. Following tradition, President Biden has issued this year's proclamation. In recognition of the achievements of Hispanics, the Congress, by Public Law 100-402, as amended, has authorized and requested the President to issue annually a proclamation designating September 15th through October 15th as National Hispanic Heritage Month. Now, therefore, I, Joseph R. Biden, Jr., President of the United States of America, by virtue of the authority vested in me by the Constitution and the laws of the United States, do hereby proclaim September 15th through October 15th, 2021 as National Hispanic Heritage Month. I call upon public officials, educators, librarians, and all Americans to observe this month with appropriate ceremonies, activities, and programs. In witness whereof, I have hereunto set my hand this 14th day of September in the year of our Lord, 2021, and of the independence of the United States of America, the 246th. Signed, Joseph R. Biden, Jr. Ladies and gentlemen, in an effort to show our admiration for the Hispanic and Latino men and women that serve our nation and are assigned to the Medical Center of Excellence, we have put together this short video.
The National Hispanic Heritage Month theme for this year is a celebration of Hispanic heritage and hope. The observance of Hispanic heritage is from 15 September to 15 October of each year. The observance is celebrated during this frame due to many significant events for various Hispanic communities which fall within the observance period. The President issues a proclamation each year calling on the people of the United States, especially the educational community, to observe National Hispanic Heritage Month with appropriate ceremonies and activities. Hispanics have had a profound influence on our country throughout their strong commitment to family, faith, hard work, and service. They have enhanced and shaped our national character with centuries-old traditions that reflect the multi-ethnic and multicultural customs of their community. My heritage and my culture has made me the soldier that I am today, because before I joined the military, I have witnessed extreme poverty. And extreme poverty for me, it's what keeps reminding me of the value of me being in the military, having a family, and seeing everything. I just value the fact that my kids have a house, food, clothes, shoes, things that a lot of people take for granted. Education, they can learn the words and read, and stuff that a lot of kids and a lot of people in other countries do not have.
Hey, good morning. I'm First Lieutenant Felix. I am the 264 HHD commander, and I'm originally from the Dominican Republic, Santo Domingo, the capital. My parents actually ensure that I was brought up the right way. The military just kind of enhanced that, the same values pretty much that I was brought up with. Diversity. It's always good to have a different perspective. Somebody might have or might add something that you have potentially not thought about just because the way that he or she were brought up were completely different. And I think it's just always an asset for the military and this organization to have different points of views from different parts of the world.
I am original from Cuba, La Habana specifically, and half of my family, for part of my mom, is from Spain and the other part from Cuba. I am very proud because for many Hispanic people, it's very hard sometimes in different countries to be successful. And for me, be part of the army and be seeing my dreams coming true is something I enjoy. I am very proud.
Growing up in a Mexican Hispanic household, the father was the final authority, kind of like a company commander. My mother would be sort of like the first sergeant. Any issues or concerns we had to go through my mom before they escalated to my dad. If for any reason it couldn't be handled at the lowest level with my mom, we would get my dad involved. And his decision was the final authority.
When my mom was about 3 years old, she migrated from Cuba with just my grandma and one sibling. So back home, she left all her family. So growing up, we really didn't have much family. All we had was each other. In the Army, I was able to develop a family, a home away from home, and meet a lot of people, and we were all that we had.
And my favorite part would have to be the food. Food and the holiday season. I mean, Dominicans do it big. Every time, you know, holidays comes around, it's like the whole country goes into their own state of emergency in a sense. And it's all about literally what we're eating, who we're hanging out with. And it's just the overall atmosphere just becomes all centered around family and just enjoying that time and cherishing that time that we have.
My favorite part of my heritage is Dominican Independence Day. That's when we get together. We celebrate Independence Day and we eat food, we dance, we listen to music, and we go about our day.
My favorite part of my heritage, it's my dual language. I find myself translating over and over and over in my head all day long. I call it a superpower. I tell my son this every day. That is just a little superpower we cannot lose. It's just simply arriving to the office and saying, buenos dias! And everybody just turns around because the office is so quiet, but then you see their smiles. Like, I don't change that ever. Like, it's like a buenos dias every day, regardless of what happens.
We would like to thank MEDCoE TV for putting together that amazing video. And now, ladies and gentlemen, please help me give a warm welcome to Jonathan and Jennifer, owners of Esta Noche Dance Company. Great job. Great job by Esta Noche. Wonderful, wonderful job. Colonel Rose Linda Smyth was born in Harbor City, California, and is a first-generation Hispanic American to parents that were not born in the United States. Her father, Eduardo, is from Ancon, Lima, Peru, and her mother, Carmen, is from Tacuala, Nayarit, Mexico. Colonel Smyth currently serves as the Assistant Chief of Staff Operations, G37, for the United States Army Medical Center of Excellence. Colonel Smyth's full bio is located in your program. Please join us in welcoming our guest speaker, Colonel Smyth.
Great icebreakers leading up to my portion of today's events. Major General LeMaster, Sergeant Major Charpentier, thank you so much for this opportunity. I'm humbled to represent today's Hispanic Heritage Month and be your guest speaker. I don't know if I am worthy of this request. I was asked shortly after my promotion ceremony, and I believe it had to do with some folks that were present, because I largely spoke to what led me to be where I was today. And it largely focused on my parents and my upbringing, not the expanded version. And I asked Lieutenant Felix, so how much time do I have? You know, I'm the type of person that needs borders. Like, you need to tell me. He's like, ma'am, you can take 15 minutes, you can take an hour. So we'll see what you get today. I'd like to say thank you to Colonel Princess Atunrazi. So today is the first time I've ever met her. That was a beautiful rendition of the national anthem, and it certainly blankets the patriotism that followed my childhood into adulthood, all because of my parents. So as the narrator mentioned, my parents were both, you know, not from the United States. Through happenstance, ended up meeting each other when my mom got off the bus in Los Angeles on her way back to Mexico, because a friend had convinced her, let's just stay here this weekend. And my mom was on a work visa, working in a textile warehouse up in San Francisco. And she was reluctant and kept telling her friend, you know, I don't want to do this. I always go home every, you know, I didn't even tell my mom I wouldn't be coming home. And her friend convinced her, and then that's the weekend that she met my father. And so obviously I'd like to say the rest is history, but there's a lot that existed in between that time. So following their courtship and relationship, my dad at first, having been brought over only about a year prior to their meeting by his brother, he was working at a gas station pumping gas, and that was his job. And soon after that, his brother was able to get him into the shipyard, which was the shipyard right there in San Pedro. So although it does, you know, the narrator mentioned born and raised in Harbor City, well, that's where the hospital was. That's where I was born, but I was raised in San Pedro, California. And whenever people hear me say that, they'll say, isn't it San Pedro? And it's like, well, then you're not from San Pedro, because everyone who's from San Pedro calls it San Pedro, not San Pedro. Or you just call it Pedro. And so with that, my dad started working at the Navy shipyard. And my mom, and both of them at this time, taking night school classes so that they could learn English and prove their English. My mom had been a beautician in Mexico, and she'd only gone to school up to sixth grade. My dad was fortunate enough to finish school up to high school and graduate out of a school in Lima. But my mother only went to school to sixth grade, just given circumstances in the family, and started working as a beautician with her sisters. They had previously held a restaurant for the family, but again, because of family circumstances that had happened, with my grandfather passing away and the oldest passing away in a lightning storm, they just had to sort of figure things out. My grandmother had 13 children, 11 who survived. And so the bond in Hispanic families that you find is not unique. It is something that you see in across the Hispanic culture. And so when my mom, along with all the other siblings, you know, are doing their best to just sort of make ends meet, eventually my mom ended up with that work visa and then eventually ended up in the United States. She ended up going to beauty school, and this is when I was really young. I mean, she's surprised that I even remember these memories. I was probably like 3 years old or something, because she would take me with her to the beauty college, and I got to sit either like right below her feet, you know, or she'd give me those doll heads to just go and like brush the hair and go sit over there. But I got to witness a lot by being around my mother, in terms of what I later recognized, my gosh, you know, her whole life she's had to hustle. And my dad, although I never got to see him at work, I would see him come home. And I mean, you would have thought he was like dipped in oil. He'd come home with his black lunchbox. And as soon as I was old enough to sort of figure out how to run things in the kitchen, I was the one up at 5 making his lunch. The first time I did it, he was like, "What are you doing awake?" And I'm like, "Well, I wanted to get your lunch ready, Dad." You know, I was just so excited to do something for him. And so that became a common theme. But there was also another reason why I loved getting up early, because it was quiet. And in a Hispanic family, things are never quiet. And so the earlier I could get up, I could turn on the news. I mean, I know that sounds ridiculous, but and then I could just make his lunch, and things would start off well for me mentally. So as I saw my dad continuing to work at the Long Beach shipyard, unfortunately, circumstances again happened, and the shipyard closed, and then he moved to the Navy shipyard. But when he started working at Todd Shipyard, the one that was right there in San Pedro before its closure, it was evident ever since we were very, very young, his love for America, and basically his communication to us with being patriotic. And it didn't mean that he turned his back on his home country, but there was not an Olympics we did not miss. My sister and I would perform, we'd put on our swimsuits, pretend we were gymnasts, you know, we had swimsuits with like the American flag on them, and do all of these things that I, again, not until much later recognized that he really built that patriotism in our family and always encouraged us to, you know, strive for whatever we could, you know, to have no limitations, and my mom the same. But I would see, again, being more around my mother, she ended up opening up her own beauty salon and held it for 20 years. And this is someone with no education. She would round us up in the van, because we had a family van. Round us up in the van, we'd go to the library, she'd make photocopies of a flyer that basically she'd handwritten with her business card photo x-rayed, you know, on the printer, and drop us off at random parking lots and like, go put these on the windows. And it was a 10% off or 15% off coupon if you came to Carmen's. And that was her name. That is her name, Carmen. And that was the name of her salon. And so between my sister and I, we had the privilege of always being able to go with her to work, you know, washing off the sidewalk, cleaning the front windows, wiping up, sweeping up hair, to the point that we evolved to now I could put in curlers for the ladies coming in to get a perm, and I'd get my little 50 cents, you know, for a tip, or removing curlers or getting someone moved into the dryer. But with all of that being said, every week what I also got to see is on Saturday evenings she'd close out the register, in essence kind of round up what she did for the week. And she was open Tuesday through Saturday. And again, it didn't mean nothing really to me then. It didn't mean something to me until much later. Is that every week she'd literally bankroll close to $1,500, $1,200, I mean, somewhere around there. And again, thinking back at that era was, my gosh, you know, she was doing really well, supporting 4 kids, supporting a family, and running her own business. And granted, you start to shave off the rent, the supplies, but wherever we could sort of save money, we did. She would bring home the towels, and you know, we always said we were slave labor. And I don't mean that. It was just one of those things like, I think we only exist to do this. But she'd bring home the bagfuls of towels. We'd sit there and fold them all up, wash them, fold them all up, and then get them ready for her to take back for the week. One of the other things that I shared at my promotion was just, you know, how stringent my father was with being sort of economical, I'll call it, financially savvy. So we weren't allowed to use our vacuum cleaner in the house, unless we actually had people coming over, but that didn't mean the carpets didn't need to be cleaned. And so we could pull out the vacuum cleaner if we had guests coming over, but otherwise it was Maggie and Rose. My older brother, I'd like to think he had other responsibilities, but I don't quite remember. And Stephen was probably too little, but Maggie and Rose, here's your buckets. And we'd have to split the house in half and literally on our hands and knees start picking up the lint and putting it into the buckets. So I think about picking up cigarette butts when I was enlisted and in basic training and all of those things that we have responsibilities. It's like, oh, I got this. I know how to do this well. And he'd check our buckets to see how much lint each of us had collected. And it was like, nope, you don't have enough. You need to go back, or you're good. You can go ahead and go and dump it. We had his favorite timeout spot, where if we weren't doing so hot, we would have to go and kneel where our fireplace was and just hold our arms out. And I just think about, like, my gosh, we were completely in training this whole time that I was being raised. We really weren't allowed to use hot water, and he would check it before, you know, we'd shower, and so there better not be any steam in that bathroom when you were coming out. And so you were always very quick to do that. And I remember those things when I was very young. And that resiliency starting to get built from such a young age that, again, I didn't recognize that then until much later. Fast forward, when my dad was transitioned over to the Navy shipyard in Long Beach because Todd had closed, to him working at like the Navy shipyard, this is now not a private shipyard, this is the Navy shipyard. You know, my dad, again, not from here, a foreigner, I mean, he might as well have been in the Navy. He would sport Navy sweaters and any vessel that he worked on. He made sure to always go and purchase the hats. His proudest vessel that he ever got to work on was the USS Missouri. And I mean, to this day, he still has his hats. I mean, and again, you would think that he served in the Navy because he got to work on those vessels. And again, we largely grew up around that, so he would always take us when there were openings, when families could come aboard the ships and take a look at, you know, what was there. And we, of course, thought it was the awesomest thing to see, like the triple stacked beds and, you know, what a lifestyle. And I think now, and I'm like, oh my gosh, you know, how do those folks do it when they're at sea for that long? But again, going back to what has brought me to now is that with everything that my parents had gone through and what I saw them do over time and evolve naturally created what I think was someone who just desired to look at what else there was to offer in life. What else is there to seek out? I kind of hit some bumps along the way when I was in high school. In 10th grade, I had decided that I loved surfing more than being at school. And so doing that my first semester of my 10th grade year, the vice principal ended up calling me into her office at the end of the first semester and said, you can't come back. Your grades are atrocious and you need to go and fix this before you're allowed back in. And I was devastated. Here I thought I was being kind of maybe sneaky enough, like, oh, my parents aren't seeing my grades. Like, I get to go hit the beach. I'm going with my friends. This is what I'm doing. And then I ended up in Angels Gate, which is a school that, like, is known for, like, all the bad kids. And so I was mortified. So talk about like what was mentioned in the video of like the mom being the first sergeant and the dad being the commander. I begged my mom to high heaven, please do not tell dad, like we can fix this. You know, I'm sitting here asking her to wheel and deal with me how to make this right. Because it more so had to do with being extremely embarrassed of letting my dad down. So she agreed. And to this day, unless he figures out how to watch this video, he does not know that I ever had to step out for a semester and a summer at Angels Gate. I had to do night classes, I had to do summer classes to just make up for that lost time. And then of course, I was right back into classes in 10th grade, in 11th grade. So then fast forward, well, in 11th grade, I had the opportunity because of the school that I was in to do the certified nursing assistant program. They were affiliated with the local hospital in town. And so that was an amazing opportunity for any kid, a junior in school, and you could do it as a junior or a senior. But then in my senior year, I had an opportunity to interview with Northrop as it was another program affiliated between the school and Northrop Aerospace in El Segundo, where you can go, in essence, work your two electives there. And so I interviewed to be an engineer's assistant for Dr. Dinesh Joshi, and it worked out that I got it. And so for my senior year, that last 2 hours of the day, I would catch the bus right when lunch started, eat lunch on the bus, and I had that opportunity to sort of broaden my perspective of what there is in life. I want to say that all of those experiences coupled together, obviously, is what enabled me to make the decision to come into the Army. I didn't wake up one day and say, I want to go to the recruiter. My dad had used my college money that my mom had saved and the college money that my mom had saved for my sister so that they could put a down payment on their first house that they actually owned and bought. What my dad, as the commander, never told the first sergeant was that he had used that money. So I applied to different colleges and I got into NYU and I needed to send in my first, you know, you need to send in your first sort of check to stabilize your room and board and all of that. And I told my mom, and it was the first time she was gonna let me have reins on that checking account or that savings account. She gave me the account number and said, okay, you know, go ahead and get that cashier's check at the bank. And I went there and I'm so excited. And I told the lady, you know, here's my account. I need a cashier's check for this amount. And she just kind of looked at me a little odd and she slipped back this little piece of paper and she said, I'm really sorry, but this is all that is in here. And it was like less than 1,000. I mean, it was like 700, who knows, 600, somewhere around there. And I just walked away completely frozen thinking, what just happened? I recognize now that all of that time being told, all this, you know, I'm saving money for you, I'm saving money for you, which she had since we were very, very young. But it was important to my dad to put down that down payment as well, and they were able to put down $70,000 at that time. And so then it was figuring out, well, what am I going to do? Because I'm not staying here. It's not that I didn't value my family. It's not that I didn't care for my siblings or aunts and uncles, but I just knew that staying home was not going to be an option for me. My sister, by happenstance, had a recruiter who ended up soliciting her at the high school because that's when recruiters were allowed to walk into the high schools, you know, be in the midst of students and talk to them and approach them without it being a scheduled event. And kept going back to my sister with, I want to sign you up. My sister was like, stop, like I'm not a senior this year. And finally she's like, you know what, but I know who is. You need to talk to my sister. But because she looked older than me, and to everyone, she looked like she was a senior. And so he ended up soliciting me when I was at my mom's beauty salon on a Saturday, because the recruiter station was about a block away, and said it was recruiter Ibarra. And he said, you know, I'd like to meet with you if possible. And you know, the rest is history. I ended up enlisting in 1993 in March. March 3rd was my shipment date, and I was stationed at Fort Leonard Wood, Missouri. And following that basic training experience, then I was shipped here to Fort Sam as a 76 Juliet medical supply specialist. And once I was done here, then I went to Fort Bragg. And when I was informed of what my unit would be, that I was going to a field unit, I'd not really been familiar with that term. I didn't quite make sense of how the Army was structured, even though having been through basic training and AIT, things were still a fog. I think I was probably still learning ranks. And when I heard I was going to a field unit, all I could think of was MASH. And I'm like, what? Like, I'm gonna live in a tent? Like, what is this gonna be like? This is not what I signed up for. And then I realized that's not what it meant at all. But I did arrive to Fort Bragg with seven others. And as soon as we arrived, you know, they lined us up all outside the headquarters. We were assigned to the 32nd Medical Logistics Battalion. At the time, Colonel McNabb and Command Sergeant Major Maywort were the commander and Command Sergeant Major. And apparently, whoever was serving as what we now call EAs, the secretary, was going to be departing. It was Specialist Ware. And I just remember they asked us, who here knows how to type? I couldn't shoot my arm up fast enough. Learning how to type when I was at Northrop, I was like, oh, this is awesome. I will not have to be an actual box kicker. I will be able to work the MROs. Like, I'll be behind the computer and not have to work in the warehouse. Like the warehouse portion of, you know, where you stack up the drywalls and all this stuff. And they're like, okay, you're gonna report upstairs. And I really, again, didn't know what that meant until then. I reported to the S3 shop, and as a PV2, as a private, you know, second class, I was now in an S3 shop, for the most part, all senior staff. There was another specialist who did join me a couple of months later, my friend Lori Courtney, who's still friends with me to this day, but she was in the Kilo course here, and so she was at AIT longer. And then when she arrived at Fort Bragg, it was like, okay, not only is she now in my section, but we were both like, who are you? You know, I know you. You seem so familiar. And then we realized we were the only two females that ran in the FAST group here at Fort Sam. And so it was like, you're that other female that would run in the FAST group. And so from that point forward to this day, we've remained friends. But that experience in the S3 shop, being around senior leaders, was probably the first time that I can say that really intrigued me to what it meant to potentially commission. I have to say that I really had some greats in that first assignment. And I must say that in most of my assignments, just about every single one, I've had some amazing people that I've been surrounded by. In that first assignment, for most of you folks that have spent more time in the military, I'll just say that, Mr. Dan Gall was my S3. And to see, he was already airborne qualified, and every time they'd go on an airborne operation, I just desired, like, I was the driver, but I desired, like, I can't wait to go to airborne school and, like, be with these really cool people that I get to execute these amazing operations with, instead of just being the person who comes and picks them up. Mark Strider, another individual who he spoke to me about going to Campbell University, which is how I ended up at Campbell University. Christian Miko, who was the aide to the CG when it was 44th MedCom. I mean, just, I couldn't have been in a place with greater individuals that influenced me. And I don't know if they ever knew how much they influenced me, but it basically lends to what you do day to day, how you are, and how you engage others may matter so much more than you can ever think. And so for the soldiers sitting here in the auditorium here, I hope that you recognize that while you're here taking advantage of picking the brain, if at all possible, of your battalion commanders, of your command sergeant majors, of your platoon sergeants, of the XOs, because you have no idea when you are going to cross paths with them again. And the things that you will learn from them while you are here in your training is gonna vastly prepare you for what it is that you're going to be asked to do when you finally get to your first unit, your second unit, and so on and so forth. Whether you choose to make it a career or this is just a short milestone in your young adult life, that will show itself much later. But taking advantage of the opportunities here to learn as much as you can is extremely important. Fast forward, going through commissioning, and then being able to be assigned once again to Fort Bragg, to the 44th Medical Brigade in the 261st, and then shortly after my time there as a platoon leader, as the Battalion S1 for the 261st, I was able to go to the 82nd Airborne Division. And this was now at the heels of OIF-1 kicking off. So I reported in December of 2022, or of 2002, excuse me, of 2002. We were in the field. I immediately reported, and then we went to the field. We were there for a week and a half. We'd been there a while, and then all of a sudden, we got a notification. It might have been close to midnight, and we were in the plans tent getting notified that we needed to pack up and basically go back to garrison. The commander put out that he needed key leaders, key staff in the war room. That's what they called the planning room in 2nd Brigade headquarters of the 82nd. And so I found myself that very next morning as the ASPO had not quite transitioned yet to the combat health support officer, reporting to that session and then being informed that we were identified to deploy. We didn't know what that would look like. And so the month of January was spent basically preparing for OIF-1. We knew that we would be attached to 3rd Infantry Division because the 82nd holistically was not going. And in that time, I had finally gotten my own apartment. And I think I was there a month having to close that out and then pretty much living out of my office and living with a cousin of mine that happened to be in Fayetteville. Her and her husband were there because her husband was stationed in special operations there at Bragg. And so when I could go lay my head down at her house, but for the most part, it was the couch in my office because the demand of what we needed to prepare for was just extraordinary. Next thing you know, I find myself deploying in February to Kuwait, and we packed up everything according to the packing list, but I didn't see my A bags or my B bags until month 10 of that deployment. I pretty much, our unit lived out of our rucksacks for that whole deployment, and we got laundry and bath. So we deployed in February. We got laundry and bath in October, I believe, of that year. We largely lived off of our MREs. It was a luxury when we finally got the mess kitchen set up. It didn't matter that the eggs were green, they were warm. And the deployment into Iraq itself was, I don't think any of us slept that week prior, because initially we were prepping to, in essence, jump into Bayat, jump into Baghdad International Airport. That was the plan. We realized later and were told by our brigade commander that we were a feint. We were prepped for that plan, but to create a feint because we had another organization, the 173rd, that jumped in up north. And so that created, obviously some distraction. And then we were told tomorrow, instead of jumping in with the timeline, we were informed that we had to do a ground assault convoy into Iraq. We had not slept. Now we were having to reconfigure loads in vehicles. I was placed in a PLS truck with a trailer, with another soldier that was, I think at most he was an E3. I quite don't remember because I had just met him when we did the convoy setup. And it took us about 17 hours from Kuwait International Airport to get to the border. And if you've ever been to Kuwait and if you've ever driven into Iraq, it should not take 17 hours. But because of that GAC, it took so long, and the ability to stay awake, he kept falling asleep. And finally I was like, okay, the next stop, you need to show me how to work this thing, and we're gonna switch and I'm gonna drive this. And this was before we had even crossed the border. So we went ahead, swapped positions. He didn't really sleep. I mean, I would keep like kind of shaking him and like, I need you to stay awake, I need you to stay awake. And then we were able to cross the border and finally get to our first stop. But that whole experience, I mean, you wanna talk about your heart jumping out of your chest and the, off in the distance, you could kind of see light, but you could never make out what that light was. So I can't see that, I will never say that I saw bombs going off. If anything, I did see some spectacular events when we were in Baghdad because we'd see the C-130s with their gunships hitting specific targets from the roof of our building. But other than that, and then IEDs and whatnot, but that experience of being rather young but then being shouldered with the responsibility. At that point, I'd been transitioned to the combat health support officer and having to prepare that medical plan, medical evacuation plan, for the entirety of that brigade, along with the meadows of each of the battalions, was an incredible task to be given. And the one thing that I recognized is that the leadership that I was with, and I must have reread doctrine, I don't know how many times over, to at a minimum understand the foundation that I needed to work off of. And that in itself is what got me through that whole deployment, was having that understanding, being able to be part of my team when they needed me to. And I knew I was value added the first time I got in front of our brigade commander, Colonel Fuller, when we were doing a brigade size air assault mission, and I briefed the medevac plan, and he was like, okay, Rose, thanks. And I just remember walking off, I keep calling it the stage, but it was like we all sort of would stand up in front of him and let him know what the concept of the operation was. And I remember walking off thinking, that's it? Like, there's no questions? You don't have any doubts? And I looked at the three and he's like, spot on, Rose, like you did a fantastic job. And we were able to get through that brigade size air assault event, you know, without many hiccups, I would say. So all of those experiences early on, being able to deploy my company to the surge in 06 to 08. We were there for 15 months to be able to take them into war. And again, this is being a company commander back down in the 82nd after spending 2 years on the G3 staff. And then coming back down and now being a company commander in 2nd Brigade once again, deploying to the surge, being there for 15 months, redeploying that unit. Two of my soldiers were injured, but having that success and the family that was already built based off of that first rotation, because it was that same unit. There were things that we were already prepared for. There were things that we were able to do to get us through that deployment. It's certainly a time that I look back to and I try to remind myself of the importance of knowing your job and doing it well, and not just knowing it and doing it well, but being attentive to it, being present, because when you start to sort of skin away at those things, then that's where the fractures begin. And it doesn't matter how well you think you know your job, the way that the job is executed will not meet the intent in the end. So given all of those circumstances and being able to get through all of that time in the 82nd, going to Jump Master School, the deployments, being a part of not just Haiti when I was enlisted, but then once again at Hurricane Katrina in Louisiana. That was probably the worst deployment ever. I remember telling my boss at the time, Major Drew Leindecker, I don't ever want to be on a humanitarian mission again. It was more painful to see our own Americans going through what they went through than to be deployed and seeing going through that. So having our nation go through what we've had to go through with regards to the stuff that has happened on the borders and stuff, that has been extremely difficult because those folks are coming from Hispanic countries, which my parents fully had the opportunity to get here and basically build a foundation, build a home, build a community. And I have no idea if any of those individuals will ever have that harmony that we ended up with. I had opportunities that I don't think I would have previously had. In USASOC, I was able to work the base realignment project where 7th Group relocated down to Florida. And I was the one that was between myself and the USAFIC surgeon were able to work with getting the clinic built down at Eglin, where the 7th Group headquarters is located. There was a lot of pushback between the Air Force with regards to allowing us to have sort of our own separate entity because they stood firm that all of those soldiers could just go to Eglin, Maine and get their health care. And we really had to provide a proof of concept of, no, that would not work for us because you're talking about a bus trip there, a bus trip back, half a day gone. This is not the way that we want to execute Army medicine for our service members in 7th Group. And we worked really, really hard, working alongside the engineers, the Corps of Engineers, working along with MEDCOM to build the infrastructure for the 7th Group surgeon cell offices to make sure that they would have instant access to CHCS, ALTA, and all of those things. It was monumental, and the engineers understood that. When all of this was done and it was approved, I ended up with a FedEx package that was sent to me at work, and I remember thinking, like, what is this? And I opened it up, and it was the blueprints to that clinic. And that thing has gone with me on every PCS. It's still inside of that FedEx box, but one day I'm going to end up getting that framed, because to me, that was monumental in my contribution to making sure that our service members had what they needed when they needed it. Following my experience at USASOC, then moving on to working at the Surgeon General's office, working in Germany as an O5 commander at a clinic, at the Grafenwehr Army Health Clinic, having an amazing team, General Master was our commanding general, and just I can't say enough about all of the experiences to date that have brought me to where I am. And the perseverance, again, being foundational with what my parents showed us and what they emulated as we grew up. So the Hispanic culture surely is a huge contribution, not just to the Army, but to our communities, to our other services. And you should certainly be proud and promote diversity across your organizations and be aggressive with ensuring that you are holistically pulling your team in, regardless of where they are. So although this is about Hispanic Heritage Month, I mean, it speaks to the diversity that we have amongst our ranks and the importance of that and what every individual has to offer. Giving someone just a little bit of autonomy, you may be able to see all the creativity that comes about. So with that being said, thank you so much to all of you for your time. And again, I'm honored that I could have been your best speaker, and hopefully I did this justice. So thank you.
Colonel Smyth, if you would be so kind as to stand center stage, ma'am. Ladies and gentlemen, please direct your attention to the stage as Command Sergeant Major Gilberto Colon, the 32nd Medical Brigade Command Sergeant Major, and Lieutenant Colonel Corbrians Abraham, the 264th Medical Battalion Commander, present Colonel Smyth with a token of appreciation for honoring us with her inspirational remarks. The owners of Esta Noche Dance Company for their wonderful performance. Ladies and gentlemen, at this time, the 32nd Medical Brigade, Command Sergeant Major Colon will provide closing remarks.
Major General LeMaster, Sergeant Major Charpentier, teams, families from 32nd Med Brigade. Ma'am, thank you for those kind words. Apparently, our moms are in sync, because my mom was the same way. Okay? For us, it was Saturday morning. And I still remember her telling me telling her, Mommy, la bañera está limpia. And she said, vamos a ver. Right? I used to tell my mom, hey, the tub is clean. And she'll tell me, we will see. Right? And then she'll come in and say, está sucio ahí. And it's just that little corner of the tub. I'm like, oh my goodness. Okay, I think my upbringing has made me pay attention to little things in life. So it's the little things that sometimes we take for granted, so I really appreciate it. Jonathan and Jennifer, maybe 2 years ago, I could do all those moves, right? Now I think if I do, I might pull a hamstring. Thank you so much for that presentation. Colonel Altuner, say, is she still here? She left? It always amazed me each time she renders a national anthem. I get goosebumps. I told her, are you going to sing it in Spanish? She goes, if I would have had enough time, I would have done it in Spanish. So I told her I was going to actually say that. Every year during this time frame, we celebrate Hispanic Heritage Month. And I tend to gather some information of why it's always celebrated from the 15th of September to the 15th of October. So there are certain things I did not know. I did not know that three countries in South America actually celebrate their independence today. Some of them are Costa Rica, El Salvador, Guatemala, Honduras, Nicaragua. I did not know that. I knew about New Mexico on the day that they celebrate their independence on the 16th. I knew about Chile. So I knew. So every time I tend to learn something from a different culture. What makes our organization the best organization there is? Is a diversity within our ranks, right? We are strong together because we come from different backgrounds. So today I stand in front of you saying, estoy orgulloso de ser un soldado americano y un latino. I am proud to be an American soldier and a Latin American. I know I'm keeping y'all from the cake, so I know I'm hungry and I want some cake too.
Ooh. At this time, we ask for Colonel Smyth and Lieutenant Colonel Abraham to come to the front of the stage and join Command Sergeant Major Cologne for the cake cutting ceremony. It is customary to close these types of events with the ceremonial cutting of a cake. Please direct your attention to the front of the stage. Ladies and gentlemen, please stand for the benediction delivered by Chaplain Van Dress and remain standing as we sing the Army song together. At the conclusion of our singing of the Army song, please stop by for cake and cultural refreshments in our outer lobby.
Amen. Well, as we go from this place, let's keep in mind to remember the importance of what it means to really love one another. Regardless of what we look like and what we believe in our creeds, right? We want to be grateful for the diversity in our armed forces and especially in the Medical Center of Excellence. And so I would like to end this benediction with the Padre Nuestra. So anyone who would like to join me, please pray along with me. Padre Nuestro, que estás en el cielo, santificado sea tu nombre. Venga a nosotros tu reino. Hágase tu voluntad en la tierra como en el cielo. Danos hoy nuestro pan de cada día. Perdona nuestras ofensas, como también nosotros perdonamos a los que nos ofenden. No nos dejes caer en la tentación y líbranos del mal. En el nombre del Padre, del Hijo, del Espíritu Santo. Amén. Now may we all go in peace with respect and love for one another. Amen.
March along, sing a song, we're the army of the free. Count the brave, count the true, who have fought to victory. We're the army and proud of our name. We're the army and proudly proclaim. First to fight for the right and to build the nation's might. And the army goes rolling along. Proud of all we have done, fighting till the battle's won. And the army goes rolling along. And it's high, high, hey, the army's on its way. Count off the cadence loud and strong. Wherever we go, you will always know that the army goes rolling along. This concludes today's observance. We thank you for your attendance. Thank you all for your efforts in educating the force and promoting understanding, equity, and inclusion in our Army. Have a great Army Day.